हरे कृष्णा। इस्कॉन चेन्नई वेलकम्स यू टू अनदर सेशन ऑफ श्रीमद् भागवतम। बिफोर वी स्टार्ट नरेटिंग द स्टोरी फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम, लेट अस से द प्रेयर्स टुगेदर। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय, ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। नष्टप्रायेष्व भद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवती उत्तम श्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्ठिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे हरे, हरे रामा राम राम हरे हरे। सो टुडे इज अ स्टोरी ऑफ दक्षा कर्सेस लॉर्ड शिवा, दक्ष यज्ञ। स्वयंभुव मनु, ही हैड थ्री डॉटर्स एंड टू सन्स प्रियव्रता एंड उत्तानपादा एंड थ्री डॉटर्स अकुति प्रसूति एंड देवहूति। प्रसूति वॉज हैंडेड ओवर इन मैरिज टू दक्षा। द टू हैड सेवरल डॉटर्स एंड द यंगेस्ट डॉटर वॉज सती। नाउ दक्षा, ही ऑलवेज हैड something against Shiva. This was the question asked by Vidura to Maitreya Muni. He asked him that why Daksha, who was so affectionate towards his daughter, but he was envious of Lord Shiva, who is the best among the gentle. Then next question he asks is, when Lord Shiva, he is a spiritual master of the entire world, he is worshipped by almost everybody, he does not have any enemy, he is so gentle, why Daksha is so inimical towards him? And the third question is, he says that to give up one's life is so difficult. What was it that happened between Daksha, that is the son-in-law and the father-in-law? What happened that the quarrel was so bitter, which led to the death of, which led to Sati giving up her body? So these are the questions asked by Vidura to Maitreya Muni. So before we talk about Maitreya Muni's narration, we will first try to understand the background. Now Daksha is a Prajapati. He is a son of Brahma. He is one of the 10 Prajapatis created by Brahma. Now Prajapatis are progenitors. They are supposed to create and increase the population, and Daksha was the chief amongst them. And Daksha also means expert. So he was expert in conducting sacrifices, he was expert in performing any type of work, and he was also expert in begetting children and maintaining such a big family. So that was Daksha. Now Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva is the guna avatar of Krishna. Now Krishna has different avatars. Okay, he expands himself in various avatars. So there are six categories of avatars. They are Yuga avatar, Purusha avatar, Guna avatar, Leela avatar, Shakti Avesha avatar, and Manvantara avatar. So this Guna avatar is to take care of the administration of the universe. And Krishna expands himself as Brahma, Vishnu, and Shiva. Brahma is in the mode of Brahma is in charge of the mode of passion. He creates the universe. He creates the inhabitants of the universe. Then Vishnu, he is the maintainer of the universe. And Lord Shiva, he is in charge of the third mode, that is ignorance. He is in charge of the third mode of ignorance, Guna. And he is in charge for the destruction of this universe. So Brahma creator, Vishnu maintainer and Shiva destroyer. So these are the duties which they perform in this universe. But Gunavatar is a great post. It is a greater post than Prajapati. So now Daksha is envious of Lord Shiva's exalted post of Gunavatar, quality avatar of the Lord. But there are some stories. There are other stories also, which like Daksha, you know, tries to tell that why he is against Shiva. So now there is one story from Brahma Puran. Brahma initially had five heads. The fifth head was called ego. The fifth head was ego. Once the Asuras and Devas, they had a big fight, and the Asuras, they defeated the Devas. The Devas came running to Shiva and asked him for help, and Shiva immediately, he mounted on his bull and he drove away the Asuras, and they were being watched by the demigods and Brahma. They watched the Asuras fleeing. Now the fifth head of Brahma, when he saw the Asuras fleeing, it started telling, come back, don't run away, come back, I will help you. So the demigods who were there with Brahma, they were bewildered and they reported this matter to Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva immediately, what he did, he took out the fifth head of Brahma. So this is one story where Daksha is angry on Lord Shiva because his father was hurt by Lord Shiva. Another story goes where Lord Shiva curses Brahma for lying and he says that his worship will be stopped in this material world. So these are the various reasons. Many reasons are there in the Puranas. You will find many reasons. But the Srimad Bhagavatam mentions that Daksha was envious of Lord Shiva's exalted position as the Guna Avatar, and he could not stand the closeness of Lord Shiva with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and he also could not stand the exalted seats given by the Lord, a better sitting place given by the Lord to Lord Shiva than Daksha. So Daksha was, the hatred was brewing inside him. Now we can see in this material world also. Now if you see you don't like a person, then whatever the person does for you, however good he is, this the person who hates him will always, who is envious of him, will always find some fault with him. Whereas if he likes a particular person, then all faults, they are unseen by this person. So now Daksha has already begun to hate Shiva, and whatever Lord Shiva does, he doesn't like. Now he has a youngest daughter called Sati, whom he has given in marriage to Lord Shiva on the insistence of Brahma. Why so? Because when Sati was born, already it was understood by everyone, and Brahma also told Daksha that she is the expansion of Parashakti and she should be married to Lord Shiva only and not anybody else. She will not marry anyone else. So Daksha had no option and he gave his daughter, his favorite daughter, in marriage to Lord Shiva. But he had this, hatred of Shiva always in his mind, and he just kept on telling something or the other to Sati, always criticizing Shiva. Now once what happened, Marichi, Vashishta, the great leaders of universal creation, they performed a great sacrifice. Now these sacrifices which they perform is for the benefit of the living entities, for the spiritual advance of the living entities actually. But many of them, they do this for material advance, material benefits. But originally, this great sacrifice called Satra sacrifice, which starts from 12 days to thousands of years. So this was being conducted by these great personalities for the benefit of mankind. At that time, Lord Shiva and Lord Brahma were also present at the sacrificial arena. All the demigods also had assembled over there. Now, when Daksha, he is a very powerful person, and he is a very, when he enters, he's got a very powerful personality and very effulgent also. So when he entered the sacrificial arena, everybody stood up except Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva. Now why Lord Brahma did not stand up? He is the father of Daksha. And why Lord Shiva did not stand up? Lord Shiva always is absorbed in the meditation of Lord Krishna. So he did not notice Daksha coming. He is always in meditation of Lord Krishna. But he being the son-in-law of Daksha, what Daksha expected that he should stand up and give him respect. Daksha was materially very, very puffed up. Okay. So he thinks that Shiva is subordinate to him because he has married his daughter. Because Lord Shiva has married his daughter, Daksha assumes that Shiva is subordinate to him. So those who have this gigantic ego, everything, that is when there is a lot of expectations. When there is expectations, definitely there is disappointment. Now for this expectation and disappointment, there is a story in Krishna Katha. In Lord Indra, he always used to receive oblations from the people of Vrindavan. They used to, every year they used to do Indra Puja. But that particular year, Krishna stopped the puja and the oblations was given to the Yajna, the oblations of Yajna was given to Govardhan Hill. So now Indra was so annoyed that instead of giving me the offering, they have given it to a mountain. So he was expecting every year that these people from Vrindavan, they will give him some offering and he will be accepting it every year. So when 1 year he did not get, he became so disappointed and he became so angry. So when you get angry, then you tend to make mistakes. So that's when he decided to destroy Vrindavan. But since Indra was a great devotee of Krishna, Krishna, he did not kill him like how he killed all the asuras in Vrindavan. So he wanted to teach him a lesson. And that's how he lifted the Govardhan Hill and 7 days and seven nights, everybody knows, 7 days and seven nights, he protected the residents of Vrindavan. Finally, Indra realized his folly and he fell at Lord's feet and asked for forgiveness. So when you get a particular post, you tend to get so puffed up that you don't know what you're doing. And this was the same thing what happened with Daksha. Because he was a Prajapati and he had given his daughter in marriage to Shiva, he thinks that Shiva is subordinate to him. And he chose this as an opportunity to curse Lord Shiva. So he is telling that Shiva does not have clean habits and he has given his beautiful daughter who is so enlightened and chaste to a person who is unworthy. This is what he says. And he is criticizing Lord Shiva's name. He is saying Shiva means all auspiciousness. So he is saying actually he is the most mad and inauspicious creature. In this way he is blaspheming Lord Shiva. And then he's also saying he is very dear to crazy beings in the gross mode of ignorance and he is the leader. Lord Shiva, he takes care of the people in the mode of ignorance. So it is not that he is a leader of people in mode of ignorance. He is so compassionate that he takes care of the people of in the mode of ignorance and he tries to uplift them so that they will gradually get liberation. But this was not to be understood by Daksha. When he saw that Lord Shiva is continuously sitting and he thought he is doing it on purpose and he, out of disrespect for him, he cursed him that Shiva will be deprived of his share in the oblations of Vedic sacrifices. But this was a blessing to Lord Shiva. Why? Because Lord Shiva, he is never interested in material things. And because of this curse, he did not have to associate with the demigods who are very, very materialistic. Now, from this, what is a lesson we learn? One who desires to make tangible advancement in spiritual consciousness must avoid three things, that is lust, anger, and mode of passion. Now, what is passion? You can define passion as a powerful, compelling emotion or feeling as love or hate. And now this is what? The very powerful emotion of hate was being expressed by Daksha. So, if you have to advance in spiritual life, then these three should be avoided. Now, Daksha, after cursing Shiva, he left the sacrificial arena. Now, Shiva being cursed, his followers naturally, they will not like that Shiva is being cursed. So, Nandishwara, who is his main principal follower, he becomes angry and he starts cursing the Brahmanas who are performing the sacrifice because none of them spoke in support of Shiva and they were all afraid of Daksha because they are Daksha is very opulent and is very powerful, so they did not want to hurt or disappoint Daksha. So all these Brahmanas, they were all in favor of Daksha and they did not utter anything. But Nandi, who did not like this. So he curses the Brahmanas. He says that you will be bereft of transcendental knowledge. Why? Because you are attached to this body, and that is why you will not be able to make spiritual advancement. Transcendental knowledge is to know the Lord. But if you are so attached to this body, then how can you know the Lord? Because you think it is I. I means ego. That is false ego. I am this body. So because of bodily attachment, you can never progress in spiritual life. So he says that you will always be bereft of transcendental knowledge. Then because of that, you will continue in the cycle of repeated birth and death. And you will be remain attached to fruitive activities. So this is what happens to a person when he is attached to this body. And this was what Daksha was a fine example of, this bodily attachment. He was so proud of himself. He was proud of his wealth. He was proud of his opulence. He was proud of everything. He was proud of the sacrifices he was performing. And he thought that he was the greatest. So one who thinks that one is the greatest, definitely their fall down is predicted. And Nandi, when he saw that his master was being ill-treated, he immediately cursed the Brahmanas. And he also said that Daksha in a short time will have the face of a goat. Now, why a goat? A goat is a very less intelligent animal. You know about a goat, that if you give him grass, you know, even if he's about to be beheaded in few minutes, still when you place grass in front of him, the goat will eat the grass, not knowing that the axe is going to cut his head. So that is the intelligence of a goat. So Nandi, he curses that Daksha will get the head of a goat. Why? Because Daksha's head is now swollen with pride, that he is so intelligent and he knows everything. So he says that in future he will get the head of a goat, which is less intelligent. This was a curse by Nandi. Now Nandi finished cursing, now sage Bhrigu, who is a sincere follower of Daksha, he starts cursing now. He is telling, by blaspheming the principles of Vedas, which are pure and supreme path of the saintly persons, certainly you followers of Bhutapati, Lord Shiva, will descend to the standard of atheism without a doubt. To atheist means not believing in the Lord. So he is telling that you will become an atheist and you will be diverted from transcendental scriptural injunctions. Now, Lord Shiva is beyond this Vedic injunctions because he is a pure person and a transcendental person. So a transcendental person, he need not follow the scriptural injunctions. We as ordinary human beings, we have to follow the scriptural injunctions for our purification. We are so fallen, so we have to follow the spiritual injunctions for our purification. So now they are cursing and counter cursing, that he is saying that you all will be atheists and you will not understand the injunctions, and those who do not follow the Vedas, they will be like animals, and so on and so forth. So when such cursing and counter cursing was going on, Lord Shiva, he became very morose. Not saying anything, he left the sacrificial arena. So why did he do this? Because he's a topmost Vaishnava. Lord Shiva is known as the greatest Vaishnava. The Srimad Bhagavatam mentions Lord Shiva as Vaishnavanam Yatha Shambhu. So amongst the Vaishnavas, he is the topmost. And a true Vaishnava is a very tolerant person. So when all this was going on, he saw Nandi and Bhrigu, both of them cursing and counter cursing. He chose to get up and walk because both of them were devoid of spiritual knowledge. They did not think about how you should be elevated spiritually, and they were falling by cursing each other. So he thought that if he remained there, then this cursing and counter cursing will go on and the situation will become very bad. So he leaves the place and he walks off. So after Lord Shiva also goes, now these sages, they continue with the sacrifice for thousands of years and they complete the sacrifice. And after the sacrifice is completed, the demigods, they take their share of oblations and they go back to their abode. Now, all this has happened. Lord Shiva has not mentioned anything to Sati that all this has happened. But still, Sati knew about the animosity between her husband and Lord Shiva, because whenever she is to meet Daksha, he uh, he used to always criticize Lord Shiva and say something about him which Sati did not like. So now what Daksha wanted, he wanted to insult Lord Shiva further by organizing another great sacrifice and not inviting Lord Shiva. He wanted to conduct the sacrifice only for Lord Vishnu, but he did not realize that Lord Vishnu, he accepts the oblations given through the demigods and through the devotees only. And Daksha, he did not realize this, or he did not understand this, or because of his hatred for Lord Shiva, he did not want to invite Lord Shiva. And he did not, inform them at all about the sacrifice, but he informed all the demigods about this, and they were all invited. Lord Vishnu, Brahma was all, they were also invited. But Lord Brahma and Vishnu, they did not go for the sacrifice where Lord Shiva was not invited, because they knew a sacrifice, the offerings of the sacrifice, if not given to an exalted person, will result in something very bad. So they did not go there. Now the sacrifice is being organized. All the demigods, they are all flying on the sky in their airplanes with their wives, and they are talking amongst each other. Sati, she is seeing that all these demigods are flying. They are dressed so well, and she wants to know where they are going. So through their conversation, she realizes that her father is organizing a great sacrifice, and they're all going to attend the sacrifice of her father. So now naturally, when she hears that there is a great sacrifice going on in her father's place, she wants to join. She wants to join the sacrifice. Now, any woman, when they see that somebody is going to the house or some big event is taking place there in the parents' house, and they also desire to join them. So Sati, being very young, she also wanted to join, and she thought that this is a nice opportunity for me to meet my father, my mother, and my sisters. So she also wanted to go. But she was hesitant. She knew about Lord Shiva and her father's strained relationship. So she goes and approaches him and asks for his permission to go for the sacrifice. And she says that even though we have not been invited, when Lord Shiva says that we have not been invited, she says, even though we have not been invited, there is no harm in going to one's friend's house or husband's house or spiritual master's house or father's house without invitation. You don't require invitation to go to people who are very close to you. This is what she is trying to impress upon Lord Shiva. So Shiva, now he remembers all what Daksha had spoken in the first sacrificial arena, but he does not tell her about it. He just warns her. He says, your father is too puffed up with material possessions. So he would be angry, and this would be intolerable for her. What he is trying to say is that Daksha, he was of a very high position, and if Sati went there with her, because he has not invited Sati, so he says, if you go there, your father will insult you because of your being my wife, because of your being my wife. So it is better that she not go there. And he also tells Sati that if you go there, and that is, if a person who goes to a place uninvited, then what happens if that person is very close to you and he showers words with anger about the bodily association, then that will be a great insult, which will be equal to death or even worse than death. So he advises her not to go. He says, this will be not good for you. So you please do not go. Now, he tells that your father, he was very angry with me because I did not offer obeisances to him. But you know me, I am always engrossed in the meditation in the Supreme Lord Krishna. So he says, your father is undoubtedly worshipable, but take care, for although he is a giver of your body, he may also be the taker of your body. So he is a giver of your body means it is Sati was born to him, so he is the giver of her body. Saying so, death may occur also because of him. Why? Because of the insult which he will insult because of his association with Shiva, because of Sati's association with Shiva. So he tells that you do not go there. And in spite of this instruction, if you go there, then the future will not be good to you. You are the most respectable, and when you are insulted by your relative, this insult will immediately be equal to that. He also tells Sati that there are, you know, some people have all the good qualities, but if the good qualities are misused, then it is very bad. Like he says, there are six qualities like education, austerity, wealth, beauty, youth, and heritage, which are highly elevated. But one who is proud of possessing all this, then he loses his good sense and cannot appreciate the glories of great personalities. So Daksha has all the good qualities which is mentioned here, but he hates Lord Shiva. So it is like he is puffed up by all these possessions, and that is why it produces a very bad result. Now, Chanakya Pandit, he gives a very good example. He says, a snake, it may have a jewel on its head, but a snake is a snake. What is the nature of a snake? The snake will bite. So even if it is having a jewel on its head, the snake is always envious of other living entities. And because its nature is to be envious, its nature is to bite, it will definitely bite. So you have to be careful even of a snake which has a jewel on the head. So your father, he's got all the jewels, but because he is envious, so you have to be very careful of him. You should not go to him. This is the advice Lord Shiva gives Sati. So what is the life lesson? That one should not go to anyone's house, even on the consideration of his being a relative or a friend. When the man is disturbed in his mind and looks upon the guest with raised eyebrows and angry eyes. So never go to the house of a person who is envious. When you know that he is angry, or when you know that he is envious, when you know that you will not be welcomed by him, you should not go to such a person's house, even if that person is a very, very close relative of yours. This is one lesson every one of us should learn from this Lord Shiva's Leela. Now, Sati, now any woman, now if a woman is forbidden by a husband that you should not go to your mother's house, what will happen? She will get agitated, because once the thought comes into a house that I have to go to my mother's house, means then she has to go. She wants to see her parents, she wants to see her siblings, all that desire rises. So this was the same case with Sati. First thing is, such a big sacrifice is being performed, and she wants to join that, and she wants to meet all her siblings and her mother. But at the same time, she was also afraid of Lord Shiva's warning. And she did not know what to do, and she kept on oscillating and walking to and fro. And she was thinking, looking at her husband, she felt that this uncommon husband of mine, with blazing eyes, she was looking at him, and tears were falling from her eyes, and with grief and anger. And then she decided that she is going to the house of her father, and she just left. But as soon as she left, what happened? Lord Shiva's disciples, they understood Lord Shiva's mind, and immediately they followed Sati. They did not want to let her go alone to Daksha's house. So what they did, they made her sit on a bull, they gave her a pet bird, and then they covered her with a big canopy, and all of them, they proceeded towards Daksha's house as a great procession, singing, blowing conches and trumpets, and finally the entire procession reached Daksha's house. When Sati reached there, she saw that the entire place was so opulent and so well decorated. She was very happy to enter the house. But all the demigods were seated there. None of them, they welcomed her because they feared Daksha. But only her mother and her sisters, they welcomed her. Sati was not, she did not accept their reception. They also gave her many gifts, which also she did not accept. She went to the sacrificial arena, and she saw that her father was standing there, and she tried to talk to him. But Daksha, who was so puffed up, his ego was so puffed up that he didn't even look at his daughter. And then she kept on looking at him with such blazing eyes that her eyes would burn Daksha. She was so furious. And then she watched, what did she see then? All the oblations were being offered to all the demigods except her husband, Lord Shiva. So she became very angry. And then she looked at her father as if she would burn him with her own eyes. So how she addresses him? She is condemning her father. Twice born Daksha. Twice born means a Brahmana. So she's saying, oh, twice born, Daksha, a man like you can simply find fault in the qualities of others. Lord Shiva, however, not only finds no faults with others' qualities, Lord Shiva is such a person that even in the most fallen, he will see some good quality and he will highlight it. That is the quality of Lord Shiva, so merciful. And he who has no fault, she finds that, she tells Daksha that he who has no fault, you are finding so many faults with him. And she says, you are committing the greatest offense by envying. She is saying Lord Shiva's position is constitutionally higher than that of Lord Brahma, because Shiva is in the next, that is Krishna's next expansion, that is from Krishna comes Shiva. So Shiva is almost equal to Krishna, but not equal. You can say he is like how, you know, they say milk and curd. In Brahma Samhita, Brahma describes this, the relation of Krishna and Shiva, that when milk is formed into a curd, so that is what, Krishna is milk and the curd is Shiva. The Shiva, that is milk can be converted into curd, but curd cannot be converted into milk, but the origin is the same, it is a milk. So that is the position of Lord Shiva. He is the greatest personality. So, and his position is higher than Lord Brahma. Though Lord Shiva appeared as the son of Brahma. How he appeared as the son of Brahma? When Brahma created the four Kumaras and he asked them to recreate, they refused. So when they refused, Brahma became so angry, and from between his eyebrows, a small child came crying. So the child was called Rudra. That was Shiva. So though Shiva appeared from between the eyebrows of Brahma, he has a higher position than Brahmaji. This is what Sati is informing her father. So, and she says, if one hears an irresponsible person blaspheme the master and control of religion, one should block his ears and go away if unable to punish him. So what Brahma, that is, Daksha has been cursing. So she says it is very wrong even to hear the blaspheme of Lord Shiva. And then she is saying, now this body, saying whenever Lord Shiva, he addresses me as Dakshayini, I feel so morose because it reminds me that I have got this body because of you. Dakshayini means daughter of Daksha. So she says, I become morose because I'm always reminded that I am your daughter, and I condemn this body because I have received it from you. A person who has blasphemed Lord Shiva, I don't want this body from that person. So it is, she's telling, if someone has taken food which is poisonous, the best treatment is to vomit. So what she decides to give up her body, because this body, she feels, is the giver of this body is Daksha, and Daksha is a person who is blaspheming Lord Shiva. So she does not want to be connected in any way, in any bodily relation with Daksha. And immediately she sits on the that place facing north, and she concentrates in the process of mystic yoga. And then she, with the fiery energy from within, she annihilates her body. So when she does this, there is a great uproar in the sacrificial arena. But all this is being watched by Daksha, and he's so hard-hearted that he does not even go to save his daughter, just because she is the wife of Shiva, and whom he hates. So he does not even stop her from giving up her body. Such a hard-hearted person. Now, what happens when this followers of Shiva, they see that Sati has given up her body, they immediately start to attack the and stop the sacrifice. When Bhrigu Muni sees that they are all coming to attack and the sacrificial fire will be stopped, he immediately chants some mantras and offers oblations to the fire. Immediately, thousands of demigods called Ribhu, they come. They get manifested, and all of them, what they do is they drive away the assistance of Sati, and these people, out of fear, they run away and they disappear. So the life lesson, we have anger, and that anger can be a great quality when directed against a person who is envious of Supreme Personality or Godhead or his devotee. Now this very nice example is that of Hanuman. When Sita was kidnapped and kept in Ashokvan by by Ravan, Hanuman, no sooner he had darshan of Mother Sita, what he did, he wanted to give the taste of Ram's strength to Ravan. So immediately that anger, he actually, if he wanted, he could have carried away Sita from there. He was strong enough for that also. But Sita wanted that Ram should come and kill Ravan and take her. So what Hanuman does is, he straight away, when he was caught, he creates a lot of aggression over there in Sri Lanka, and he is caught and his tail is set on fire. So what he does, that anger, he sets Lanka on fire. So he uses that anger in the service of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So one should not be tolerant when a person is offensive towards Vishnu or Vaishnava. Now here, this is a picture of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He is protecting Nityananda Prabhu from these two miscreants who are Jagai and Madai. Now these two miscreants, Jagai and Madai, they were born in very high Brahmana family, but due to bad association, they became drunkards and they had all the possible vices. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had just started to propagate the Nama Sankirtan, and his first two disciples, Nityananda Prabhu and Haridas Thakur, he sent them to preach about the holy names to everybody. So Nityananda Prabhu, what he says, these two, Nitai, Jagai and Madai, they are really most fallen. So we will go and first tell them to chant the names. We should preach to them first. But they were in such drunken stupor that they drove away, they chased Nityananda Prabhu and Haridas Thakur, that they both ran for lives. Then again, next day when they saw Nityananda Prabhu, Jagai, what he did, he took a piece of pot and he threw it on Nityananda Prabhu, and his forehead started bleeding. And this news reached Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. When he saw that his devotee has been hurt by someone, he comes immediately. And since he is the incarnation of Krishna, he takes the Sudarshan Chakra immediately to kill him. So at that time, Nityananda Prabhu, because Nityananda Prabhu is his great devotee, so to protect him, he is ready to kill. That is, Lord Krishna, he is such a person that if he is offended, he does not take this offense very seriously. But if his devotees or some Vaishnava, they are offended, he does not take it lying down. Immediately, he will attack the person. So in this way, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he wanted to kill Jagai and Madai. But because of the mercy of Lord Nityananda, they were saved and they became great devotees by mercy of Lord Nityananda and Chaitanya Prabhu. So when you have anger, that anger can be a great quality when directed against a person who is envious of the Supreme Personality of Godhead or his devotee. Now, frustration of the sacrifice of Daksha. Now, what happens is, here Sati has given up her body. Narada, he goes and he informs Shiva that Sati has given up her body. She was insulted by Daksha, and all the followers, they have been driven away by the Ribhus. So Shiva, he was so annoyed that he took a strand of hair and he dashed it to the ground, and a very fearful person called Veerabhadra, with thousands of arms and equipped with various weapons, was created. He asked Lord Shiva, what should I do? Shiva said, immediately go and kill Daksha and his soldiers in the sacrifice. So here what has happened now, here there people are discussing that Daksha is so hard-hearted, he could not even save his daughter. Why did he behave in such a way with his daughter? As they were discussing all this, they could see the entire place becoming dark, and they were wondering what's happening, Daksha, he could see all the ill omens, he could hear all the ill omens. And Prasuti, she immediately understands. She's a soft-spoken and very intelligent person. She immediately understood that this was something going to happen because Sati, the wife of Shiva, was dead. So this was the result. Because Shiva's wife has died, definitely there is going to be some reaction. She expected this. So now all these Shiva's followers, they follow who? Veerabhadra. As soon as he comes, all of them, they destroy the sacrificial arena. They break all the pots, the fire, they throw all various things into the fire, and they kill, maim all the demigods, they break their hands, legs, and they started creating so much of disturbance over there. So Maniman, one of the followers of Lord Shiva, he arrested Bhrigumuni. Why? Because Bhrigumuni, when Daksha was cursing, he laughed. So that's why he arrested Bhrigumuni. And Veerabhadra, the black demon, arrested Prajapati Daksha. So Veerabhadra, he straight away he caught hold of Daksha and he cut off his head. And Bhrigu Muni's beard was pulled by Maniman. Then another follower was named Chandesa, arrested Pusha, and Nandishwara arrested the demigod Bhaga. So Pusha's teeth also were broken and Bhaga's limbs were broken. So all these people who laughed at Lord Shiva and at the time when Daksha was cursing, they were all punished by Veerabhadra. Veerabhadra tore off the mustache of Bhrigu and he knocked the teeth of both Daksha and Pusha. Instead of sacrificing animals with a wooden device, immediately, what did Veerabhadra do? He cut off Daksha's head and to everyone's astonishment, what did he do? He threw the head in the sacrificial fire. Then after setting fire to the entire area, they left. So now what happens? The demigods who were there till then, they were always singing glories of Daksha. They all went running to Brahma out of fear because all this has happened. Now the yagya has stopped. There will be, it is incomplete. So now what has to be done? They all go running to Lord Brahma. So Brahma, after hearing this, he says that how can you attend the sacrifice when an exalted person is not invited? So you want to join with Daksha for your selfish interest, for your materialistic benefits, and you all did not think about Lord Shiva. When he is not invited, you all did not think that you all should not join. So you cannot be happy by executing a sacrifice if you blaspheme a great personality. So whatever material benefit also if you want, if you insult a great personality, how can you enjoy the material benefit? The sacrifice should be done as per the scriptures. Everything, everyone should be respected and great personality should be respected, especially Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva, he may not be participating or he may not be actually performing sacrificial fires, but he is beyond that. He need not do that. And Sati also tells her father that my husband is beyond this. He is pure, just like how sun and fire, they are pure. And you don't need anything to purify them. So also my husband is very pure. He is very transcendental. And he not follow the Vedic injunctions to purify himself. It is all for the materialistic people who think that, who are very puffed up because of the opulence and so many followers and intelligence and all that. So she has tried to explain a lot to her father, but he did not respond at all. So much was his hatred for Lord Shiva. And it is really clear that his hatred for Lord Shiva was because of Lord Shiva's exalted position as a Gunavatar. So now Brahma is advising them. Now you have not done a good job by joining the sacrifice in which Lord Shiva was not invited, where he was insulted, and you have not done a good thing. So what you should do is, without any hesitation, you should go and surrender unto him and fall down at his lotus feet. He will definitely be pleased. Now, Lord Shiva, he is also known as Ashutosh. Ashutosh means one who is easily pleased. And that's why the demons, they all worship Lord Shiva, because Lord Shiva is easily pleased. He does not see this person is a demon or this person is a demigod. Once they come to him and once they perform austerity, he's so pleased that he grants them whatever they want. So Brahma is telling, now without any mental reservation, you go to Lord Shiva and you ask for forgiveness. He will definitely be pleased. So now Brahma, he is taking all of them. He is taking all the demigods to Kailasa Hill, which is the abode of Lord Shiva. So the Srimad Bhagavatam, it describes the beauty of Kailasa Hill in detail. So now while these people are going, everybody, all the demigods, they are headed by Lord Brahma. They see that there is a huge banyan tree, which is 800 miles high and its branches spread over 600 miles around. Such a huge tree. And there is absolutely no sound at all over there. We can infer that there were no nests of birds also over there, because there is absolute silence and the perfect atmosphere for meditation. And they saw that Lord Shiva was sitting under that tree, grave and saintly. That is, now all that anger has gone out of Shiva, because Veerabhadra is anger personified of Shiva, and all that anger has gone out of him. Shiva is a transcendental person and he has forgiven, but he was sitting grave over there. He has lost his young wife and he has also been inflicted sharp words by Daksha. So Brahma says that despite all this, if you go and ask him for forgiveness, he will definitely forgive. So they all pay obeisances to Lord with folded hands. And Shiva, As soon as he saw Brahma, because Brahma is his father, as soon as he saw him, he got up and he paid respects, touching Brahmaji's lotus feet. Now Brahmaji is satisfying Lord Shiva. That is, now when a person is angry, you will try to pacify them with some sweet words or try to console them and all that, because now the sacrifice also has to be completed, and because of Lord Shiva's curse, now everybody is injured and the sages are not able to complete the sacrifice, which is for the spiritual upliftment of the living entities. So Brahma wants to remind Shiva that he is in charge of this material world, and he is in charge for the material, for the upliftment of the people. So it behooves that Shiva should arrange that the sacrifice is completed. So he is trying to pacify him, because naturally Sati is just dead. How can you pacify a person who is in so much grief? So that's why he is telling him, he's using sweet words, he's saying, you are the controller of the entire material manifestation, the combination, father and mother of the cosmic manifestation. He says that if in some places materialists were already bewildered by the insurmountable illusory energy of the Supreme Lord, sometimes commit offenses, a saintly person with compassion does not take this seriously. So he is hinting at Lord Shiva that he is a saintly person. And the mistakes which happen in this material world is because of the strong material energy of the Lord, the Maya Shakti of the Lord, which actually bewilders the living entities and they behave the way they do. All this ego, all these, the qualities which we have in our mind, Kama, Krodha, Lobha, Mada, Matsaryam, all this is emotions which we have in our mind because of this material world. We are not able to purify ourselves, and that is why we have to surrender to the Supreme Lord and chant his names for purification. Devotional service is the bhakti is the shortest route for purifying ourselves and for spiritual upliftment. So he says, now you are a saintly person, so you should understand this, and you being transcendental. Like when Sati was talking to Lord Shiva also, she says, you are a transcendental person, and that's why you are not affected by the relation of father, mother, sister, child. You are not affected, you are beyond that. But I am a poor woman, I don't understand this. She says, I don't understand the absolute truth. By that, what she means is, that this relation of father, mother and sisters, I think this is real. I cannot think that this is a part of illusory energy. So in the same way, now Brahma is telling him that it is because of the illusory energy of the Lord that certain people commit certain mistakes. Though Brahma was happy that Daksha was killed, because he tells the demigods that it is good that Daksha was killed, because if he continued to live, then he would commit more offenses. Like how if a murderer, he commits a murder, and if he is not punished by the king, then he will continue to murder people. So in that way, he says, Brahma was killed. Daksha was killed. It was a good thing. Because if he would be alive still with his pride and ego, he would continue to blaspheme exalted personality. So it was a good thing that he died. Now here he is again telling the Lord that you are never bewildered by the formidable influence of the illusory energy. Therefore, you should be merciful and compassionate towards those who are bewildered by the same illusory energy. Since you are transcendental to this, since you are transcendental to the illusory energy, then you should understand that those who are suffering from the effects of illusory energy, they actually need the Lord's help and the Lord's mercy, right? So that's why he's saying, so you should be more compassionate towards them. And he says, you take your portion of the sacrifice and let the sacrifice be completed by your grace. This is what Brahmaji tells Lord Shiva. So what is the lesson to be learned? In order to keep the balance of social peace and prosperity, all intelligent men should execute the performance of Sankirta Yajna. See, this was Satya Yuga when they were performing Yajna for thousands of years. Now we don't have life also. Our lifespan is very short. And the easiest way that is recommended by Lord Chaitanya is the Sankirtana Yajna, and that is the Yuga Dharma for this Kali Yuga. So Kali Yuga, what is the Yajna? It is Sankirtana Yajna. So it is easy wherever we are, whatever place we are, with whomever we are, wherever we are staying, we can easily chant the holy names of Lord Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So now Shiva is pacified by the words. Actually, Shiva has already given up his anger and he has already forgiven the demigods. But now that Brahma has come along with them, and actually when they came, they saw that he was sitting, he was surrounded by so many exalted personalities like the four Kumaras. They are liberated persons, and Lord Shiva was surrounded by the four Kumaras, by Kubera, by Narada. He and Narada, they were having discussion about the absolute truth. So Lord Shiva was explaining the Vedas to the, it's not that he does not know the Vedas. He does not have to, what to say, perform the sacrificial yagyas. It is not necessary for him, but he knows all the rules and regulations and everything. He is well versed with the Vedas. So he is explaining to Narada about the absolute truth. And when he is the supreme teacher and Narada is the supreme student, the discussion between them also will be supreme. And that is the supreme portion of the Veda is devotional service. So all this was watched by Brahma, and already Shiva, he was calm at that time. And when Brahma is pacifying him with sweet words, he says, I have already forgiven the offenses of the demigods, because he feels that the demigods are also less intelligent and for material benefits they are going and joining Daksha, so he has already forgiven them. So he says, but I punished certain demigods. Why? Because to correct them, certain offenses, only when corrected the person realizes that it is wrong to have done that way. So in certain places, the living entities have to be punished. Only then they realize that what they do is not right. Otherwise, they will continue to commit offense. So that's what he says, that I have punished them in order to right them. Then now, Daksha's head has already been burned to ashes. Now how the sacrifice will be completed? So he says he will have the head of a goat. Why goat? Because already there was a goat ready for sacrifice. So Daksha's head has already been burned in the fire. So what is to be done is, he will have the head of the goat. And the demigod Pusa, whose teeth were broken, he's saying he will be able to chew only through the teeth of his disciples. And if he wants to eat by himself, then he can have only chickpea flour. Because Pusa was another person who laughed at Lord Shiva. So these people have to be really punished. And all the personalities present were very much satisfied in heart and soul upon hearing the words of Lord Shiva. Bhrigu, the chief of the great sages, invited Shiva to come to the sacrificial arena. And what Lord Shiva did, he joined Daksha's body with the body with the head of the goat, which was meant to be killed as a sacrifice. So the goat also gets elevation, because the goat is killed for sacrifice. It gets elevation to a higher body. And that head was attached to Daksha's body. So now Daksha's body, now he has got the head of a goat, but earlier we had said a goat is very less intelligent, but we have to understand here that though Daksha, he had the face of a goat, his consciousness was the same. So the subtle body, that is the brain, mind, intelligence and ego, these are the subtle forms of our body. So they go along with our soul when you take the next body. So his consciousness, he was intelligent. So the goat's brain, that does not affect Daksha, because his consciousness, his intellect was intact. And that is why even though he had the head of a goat, he had the same intelligence. But what happened is the pollution in his heart had been totally cleansed by when he saw Lord Shiva. So he prays to Lord Shiva that I have committed a great offense against you, but you are so kind that instead of withdrawing your mercy, you have done me a great favor by punishing him. So sometimes we see that punishment is actually, we think it is as punishment from a material point of view, but a punishment is a way to correct a person or for elevation of a person. Like in Krishna Leela also, we see the sons of Kubera, they were so fallen that Narada, he cursed them to become trees, and he said that they will be liberated when Krishna in Dwapara Yuga, he will descend and he will liberate them. So instead of those boys, they were in such a drunken stupor that they did not realize an exalted personality like Narada was coming, and they were bathing naked in the Mandakini river with the female companions. And they did not bother even to cover themselves when Narada came over there. So So Narada thought that now these boys are Kubera's sons. So now if they are so rich and now they are spoiled, if this continues, then they will fall into lower species of living entities. So to save them, I have to curse them. And he curses them to become trees. And then when Krishna arrives there and by the wooden motor, he liberates these two Kuvera's sons by coming in between them, and the trees fall and the two personalities come out and they get liberated, and they also get devotional service of the Lord. So they get bhakti. So Narada has actually saved these two sons of Kuvera by cursing them. In the same way, by killing Daksha, Shiva actually, he has purified him and he has now been rectified. And that is why he is glorifying Lord Shiva. And he is regretting for, you know, telling all, for cursing Lord Shiva. He is regretting for that. Now, after being pardoned by Shiva, again the sacrifice has to begin. So they begin the sacrifice. And as soon as they start to say the mantras, immediately Lord Narayana appears there. And when he appears there, he's so effulgent that there is light all around the sacrificial fire, and everybody stand up and all of them fall flat and they pay obeisances to Lord Narayana. And everybody, as per their stature, they offered obeisance to Lord Narayana. So Daksha is addressing Lord Narayana as that you are completely spiritual, devoid of all fear, and you are always in control of material energy. Material energy is in the control of Lord Krishna only. No, he says, Devi Hesha Gunamai Mama Maya Duratyaya. So the material energy is totally under the control of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So if we surrender to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then we will not be affected by the material energy. Then Lord Shiva, he says, my dear Lord, my mind and conscience always fixed on your lotus feet, which are worshipped by all liberated great sages because your lotus feet are worthy of vision. Now, Lord Shiva is always engrossed in meditating on the Lord. So he is also offering his prayers. Then he says, I am no longer disturbed by persons who blaspheme me. Lord Shiva is not disturbed by people who blaspheme him. But because his wife Sati was killed, he got angry and he sent Veerabhadra to kill Daksha. So I do not mind their accusations, and I excuse them out of compassion, just as you exhibit compassion towards all living entities. Then Bhrigu. So each person is offering their prayers. So Bhrigu is saying that you are the protector of all surrendered souls, therefore please be kind towards and forgive our offenses. Lord Brahma is saying that your eternal form cannot be understood by any person. Now nobody can understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is the speciality of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, that nobody can understand him. He is invincible. So your position is always transcendental to the material creation. So now Lord Vishnu, he replies, he says, Brahma, Shiva and I, the supreme cause of the material manifestation, and I am the super soul, the self-sufficient witness. So he himself expands as Brahma, Shiva and Vishnu. So he says, we are the supreme cause of this material manifestation. And he is the super soul. He is there in each and every living entity. So now Daksha, the head of all Prajapatis, that is after everybody offer the prayers and all that, they worship Lord Vishnu, and after worshipping him by performing the prescribed sacrificial ceremonies, Daksha separately worshipped Lord Brahma and Shiva. That is after he worshipped Vishnu, Vishnu again he left for his abode, then Daksha he separately worshipped Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva. So now he has become humble. His head was swollen with pride. At that time, he would not bow down his head to anybody. In fact, he even referred to his father's Prateshti. That is, he did not refer to him as father. He referred to him as a teacher, that you advised me to give my daughter Sati to Shiva. And what sort of advice you have given me? This was how he spoke even to his father. And now, after this event, that is after he was beheaded and then he got purified, now he understands the position of Lord Brahma and Lord Shiva. So now, with all respect, Daksha worshipped Lord Shiva with his share of the remnants of the yajna. So Shiva was also given his share of yajna. Now, after giving up the body, now Maitreya is telling Vidur, after giving up her body, she had received from Daksha, because she abhorred her body, because it was given by Daksha. She took birth in the kingdom of Himalayas. She was born as a daughter of Mena. He tells Vidura that I heard this from authorized resources that she has been born as a daughter of Mena and the king of the Himalayas. Now, Durga, that is Parvati, Parvat, she's a daughter of Himalaya Parvat. So Parvati, who was known as Dakshayani, now again accepted Lord Shiva as her husband. That is, after years and years and years of penance, again she acquired Lord Shiva as her husband. And Maitreya tells Vidura that this story of Daksha Yajna was told to him by Udhav, the student of Brihaspati. Now, what has to be learned from this? It is not possible for any ordinary living entity to understand or glorify the unlimited personality of Godhead. But one can offer prayers or services to the Lord according to one's particular capacity. The Lord is invincible. Even Brahma is not able to understand him. Even Lord Ananta is always there with him. Even he is not able to understand him. Nobody can understand the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Let alone we fallen souls. We are very, very, very ordinary people. We cannot even try to understand anything about him. But what we can try, what we can do is, we can read Bhagavad Gita and we can read Srimad Bhagavatam, which tells about him and his devotees. And we can enjoy his unlimited pastimes. And what we can do is, we can offer prayers or service to the Lord. That is what within our capacity. Now, to chant, you do not require a lot of money. To chant, you only require a chanting bead, and you require a tongue by which you can chant the Lord's names. So at any time you can chant, anywhere you can chant, and you can do service according to one's particular capacity. Now in Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavan tells, Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam Yome Bhaktya Prayachati. That is, one can offer a flower, a fruit, a leaf, a little water. That is with bhakti. With bhakti, when it is offered, then he accepts it. And the very next shloka he tells, Yat Karoshi Yat Ashnashi Yat Juhoshi Dadashi Yat Yat Tapasyasi Kaunteya Tat Kurushva Matarpanam. Means, whatever you do, whatever you offer, whatever you eat, whatever you offer as sacrifice, everything should be given to me, Arjuna. This is what he is telling. So now first he is saying Patram Pushpam, and now he is telling whatever you do. So now here it is very important to understand the statement that service to the Lord according to one's particular capacity. Now there are people who cannot afford anything, or they may be living in the forest. So what will they offer? They have to do some service to Lord. So what will they offer? And those who are very poor, what will they offer? So for them it is Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam. But when one is comfortably situated, then whatever you eat, whatever you drink, or whatever you do, you should offer all that to him, and then you partake that as prasad. So this is as per one's particular capacity. Means, we must understand that. We must not think that, okay, he has said Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam, that is enough. He is saying with bhakti offer that, I will offer only that with bhakti. That is enough. No, 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 no. That is not correct. That is for people who do not have anything. And that is, if suppose now you are in a place where you are not able to buy anything, or you are in a position. So at that time, okay, Patram Pushpam Phalam Toyam. But otherwise, you are when you are comfortably situated, then you should offer whatever you have, whatever you eat, whatever you do, offer everything to the Lord, and then you take it as prasad. So persons who are suffering the forest fire of this material existence will only enter into the nectarian river of the description of the pastimes of the Lord. They will forget all the troubles of the miserable material existence. So material existence is compared to the forest fire. See, we are all suffering, no? Every day we are suffering. Some of the other problem arises. We think, okay, today we'll be comfortable. No, some of the other problem arises. So it is like forest fire, this material existence. So how can you come out of it? Only by listening to the pastimes of the Lord. When you listen to the pastimes of the Lord, naturally you will forget all the troubles of the miserable material existence. So that is why we keep saying, listen to Krishna Katha, listen to his devotees, because it is so engrossing that you will forget your life's problems. And you will understand that why we are suffering. We know this illusory energy is so strong that it is because of that we are suffering. And it is because of that that we forget our identity, that we are the soul, we are the Atma and not this body. So we forget that also. And because of this bodily conception, we are suffering because we relate everything with this body. So Phalashruti, if one hears and again narrates, this is what Maitreya tells Vidur, by listening to the katha of Daksha, this yagya, he says, one hears and again narrates with faith and devotion the story of Daksha Yagya as it was conducted by the Supreme Personality of Godhead Vishnu, then certainly one is cleared of all contamination of material existence, O son of Guru. So the Phalashruti also has been given that if you listen and you again narrate with faith and devotion, then all you will be cleared of all contamination. Just as the Daksha was cleared of all contamination of material existence, so also, O son of Guru, he is addressing Vidur. So one will be cleared of all contamination of material existence. So now before telling about this, I would like to just conclude this lecture with a small this about Lord Shiva. Lord Shiva, he has married Parvati. Now they have two children. One is Ganesha and one is Kartikeya. Now just you think, all of them, they have different vehicles or different vahanas. Lord Shiva's vahana is a bull and Parvati's vahana is a tiger. Now a tiger will always be ready to pounce on a bull, but still they are living together. Okay, then Ganpati, that is Ganesha, his vehicle is what? A mouse. And mouse is the enemy of the mouse will be eaten by the snake. The snake is on Lord Shiva's neck. So this is his family: Nandi, then tiger, then snake and mouse. And then Kartikeya, he is on the vahan of a peacock, and peacock is the enemy of the snake. So you have this entire family with so many different types of people who are out to attack each other. So this is just an example how, I mean, Lord Shiva, he is there with all these contradictory elements. He is there and he is always in the meditation of the Supreme Lord. So what we have to learn from Lord Shiva being an ideal family man is, there will be people in the family who are out to eat you, who are out to attack you. This is what is a family in this material world. So how to save ourselves from such people who are within our family? What we have to do is always meditate on the Lord. And how is that? The easy method is by chanting the holy names of the Lord. So now this entire month you will get a Bhagavad Gita at discounted rates. You can contact this person or any temple which is close, any ISKCON temple which is close to your residence. And thanks to Srila Prabhupada, because of whom we are able to discuss these topics of the Supreme Lord. Thank you, Srila Prabhupada. Hare Krishna.